Hey guys, this is Dr. Sangeeta and welcome back to another lecture of Dental Parchala where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And we have a special guest today because we have surgery video coming up which you all have been waiting for. So meet Mr. Venkat. So today's video we are going to talk about the mid-facial fractures. As you know, mid-face is very important for the smell, vision, as well as for the resonance of the voice. Now if you talk about the voice, so the air sinuses, we have maxillary air sinuses, all these air sinuses, because of these air sinuses we have resonance in the voice. And the bones in the mid-facial fracture actually takes up all the mastication load. And if we talk about the mastication load, it is too much. You cannot even imagine. So somewhere around 70 to 150 pounds, that will be somewhere equal to 70 kgs. So that much of load our mid-face is taking for mastication. And we have something in the mid-face which actually takes up all the loads of the muscles. Now we have the pillars, we have the bone arranged in such a pattern that they are taking all the loads of mastication. So while we are chewing, so all the load is taking up while we are chewing. Now you can see the mandible is actually elephant mandible, which we'll talk about in the fracture itself. So these bones of the mid-face are aligned in such a way that they are taking all of the load of mastication. Now there are pillars which are taking up all the mid-facial load, all the mastication load. So these pillars are known as buttresses, which we will talk about in the today's video also, and in the fracture, because these buttresses are taking up all the load. So it is very important that when we are doing the fracture management, then we are placing the fixation or we are placing the screws or the plates in the specific region in the buttresses. And as you can see, mandible is a long bone. But if we look at the facial bone, now we have so many small bones which are attached to each other, and that forms the mid-facial complex. So these bones in the mid-facial, they articulate with each other. So as you can see, this is the zygomatic bone, which is aligned with the maxillary bone. So like that, one bone is articulated with each other and therefore they make a complex. So there is not a fracture of individual bones. So there will be a fracture of combination. So there is not independent fracture of mid-facial. There will be a complex of the other fracture also. And the bones of mid-face are very thin. As you can see, these bones are very thin. So these thin cortical bones, as well as there are trabeculae pattern which is present in the maxilla, if we compare it with the mandible. Now mandible is a strong bone, but if we look at the mid-facial, there are weak bones, there are cortical. These thin cortical bones are made up of cancellous bone, so there is a porous structure, so they are very easily prone to fracture also. And because these bones are very fragile, so any force which is coming towards the skull, these bones are bearing. So any force, suppose if any injury is coming from down, so all of these mid-face is actually taking all of the stress. They are not letting the skull damage, or they are not letting the brain damage. So somehow they are protecting the brain, somehow they are protecting the skull and taking all the forces, taking all the traumatic forces on themselves, and they are crushing, and there is a fracture of mid-face while protecting for the skull or the brain. Also, these bones are protecting the vital structures such as eyes, brain and the spinal cord. So basically the mid-face is doing all of the protection work. So normally the mid-facial fracture is due to the sports injury or either a car traffic accident, any road traffic accident, assaults or any fall injury. So mid-facial fracture is not an individual fracture. It follows a set pattern of fracture. So today's video, we are going to talk about the mid-facial fracture. So without further ado, let's jump into it. Before we get started, make sure you subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon. That way you get a notification as soon as I release a video lecture. So fracture is a discontinuity of the bone. So it can be based on the displacement of the bone graft. So a fracture, it can be a displaced fracture or undisplaced fracture. So a displaced fracture is going to be when the fractured segment, it get displaced from its position. And non-displaced fracture is going to be when the fracture segment is in its previous position. So this is going to be a undisplaced fracture or a non-displaced fracture. Also based on the completeness of the fracture, it can be an incomplete fracture. So this is going to be an incomplete fracture where the fracture is not completed. And there is going to be a complete fracture where therein the fracture segment is, the fracture is basically completed. The whole, there is the complete discontinuity of the bone, and also based on the penetration of the skin. So if it penetrates the skin, then we have the compound fracture. If there it penetrates, it's come out of the skin, then we have a compound fracture. So like this, there is a penetration of the skin is the compound fracture, and if there is no penetration from the skin, then it is a simple fracture. So like that we have the classification of the fractures. Anatomy of the face we have already covered in the previous video. So basically the bones of the mid face are very thin. So the bones of the mid face are made up of thin cortical bone which have less large amount of the cancellous bone. So they are very fragile. See, half of the bones I have already fractured. The ethmoid bone is fractured in the skull. So most of the bones are very fragile, and because of these fragility they are very prone to trauma. So they can easily fracture because there is a lot of cancellous spaces which is present in the marrow, which is present in the bone. So also there is a thin cortical plate. So these bones are very fragile. These bones, they are protecting, actually they are preventing, they are acting as a cushion. So they are preventing any fracture of the cranium base. So they are protecting the cranial base. So mid face can be described as a matchbox which is placed in the cranium, which is covered by a hard shell. So any strong blow in this region is first going to go through the mid face. So if there is any strong blow to this region, it is first absorbed by the mid face bones, which get crushed first. And thereby this mid face is protecting the skull, it is protecting the bone, it is protecting the eyes, it is protecting the spinal cord. And as I have mentioned earlier, these mid face, the bones of the mid face, they articulate with each other. So there is an articulation of the mid face, like the zygomatic bone is articulated with the maxillary bone, like that, and orbital bone. So like that they are articulated with each other, and these bones, they take a load of mastication. So they take the forces of mastication. Now forces of mastication are very big, as far as the 70 to 150 pounds. So if we convert into kgs, it will be somewhere around 31 to somewhere around 70 kgs. So can you believe it? We are taking 70 kgs of the load. We can chew up to 70 kgs. And also these bones are fragile, as I have told you. But they have some force because they are taking so much of mastication load. So they have something known as the pillars in the mid face. So these pillars in the mid face, which are taking all the loads of mastication, are known as the buttresses. As if you have seen in the ancient building, the walls of the ancient building, they have buttresses in the walls. So they support, they have something support, some support for these walls. Like that we have buttresses in the face, when the mid face, in the skull, which takes up all the loads of mastication, which takes up all the load. So these buttresses, they transmit, they take the force and transmit it to the cranium structure. These forces, they first take the force within and then they transfer it to the cranium. And these buttresses, we have the vertical buttresses and the horizontal buttresses. Now these are providing strength to the bone. And also when we are fixing, when there is a fracture which is occurring, we are placing these plates, mini screws, plates, mini plates, screws, like that. When we are doing the open reduction, when we are doing surgery, when we are opening up and we are placing the plates or the screws, we are placing at these buttresses. So this is very important that we know the buttresses, because if we don't know the buttresses, then we cannot just plate, we cannot just place plates anywhere. We have to place it along these buttresses. Now we have two kind of buttresses, the vertical buttresses, the horizontal buttresses. The vertical buttresses, the first one in the vertical buttresses is the nasomaxillary buttress. These nasomaxillary buttress starts from the canine region, so starts from the maxillary canine alveolar process, and it goes towards the lateral wall of the pariform aperture, and it goes towards the maxilla and the frontal process, and it goes towards the maxillary. So the frontal process of the maxilla and towards the frontal bone. So this is the nasomaxillary buttress.
which takes the turn towards the lateral wall of the nasal aperture. So that would be the lateral wall of the nasal aperture. This one is the nasomaxillary buttress. The second buttress in the vertical buttress we have is the zygomaticomaxillary buttress. So zygomaticomaxillary buttress, as the name suggests, it is going towards the zygomatic bone. This zygomaticomaxillary buttress starts from the second molar. It starts from the second molar and it goes towards the body of zygoma and it crosses the frontozygomatic suture. Now there is, I am going to show you in the skull also. So the frontozygomatic suture, and then it crosses the body of the zygoma and then goes towards the frontal bone. So this is the zygomaticomaxillary buttress. There is a pterygomaxillary buttress. So there is a pterygomaxillary buttress which is present in the posterior part of the maxilla, which goes towards the pterygoid plates. So when I am going to show you, see the towards the first one is the nasomaxillary buttress. So nasomaxillary buttress starts at the canine fossa, goes like this towards the lateral wall of the nose, and it goes up in the frontal bone. So this is going to be the nasomaxillary buttress, starts from here, lateral wall of the nose, goes above. Now next one is the zygomaticomaxillary buttress. So zygomaticomaxillary buttress starts from here. See, it starts from here, zygomaticomaxillary buttress, and to maxillary second alveolar process and the body of the zygoma, and it crosses the frontozygomatic suture. Now you can see, can you see this frontozygomatic suture? So it crosses the frontozygomatic suture and goes towards the frontal bone. So this will be our frontozygomaticomaxillary suture. The pterygomaxillary buttress, now this maxillary is the posterior part of the maxilla and towards the pterygoid plates. So these are the vertical buttresses. Also we have some horizontal buttresses. The horizontal buttresses are the superficial orbital, the inferior orbital. So this is the superior orbital. Then we have the inferior orbital, which is at the inferior orbit. And also we have alveolar processes. So at the alveolar processes of, we have alveolar process of buttress at the alveolar process of maxilla, buttress at the alveolar process of the mandible. So one in the alveolar process of the maxilla, one in the alveolar process of the mandible. Also we have a lower transverse mandibular buttress like this. So these are the buttresses. If we are fixing any plates, if we are doing open reduction surgical technique, then we are going to fix plates along these buttresses. And these bones of the mid face are actually directed 45 degree angle. If we compare, so these are actually from the lower teeth, these are angle at the 45 degrees. So these mid face bones are, these are angle at 45 degrees, and when there is a fracture occurring at any part of this mid face, so the fracture is going to be downward and backward. Also in the pterygoid plates, there are muscles attachment. So the fracture, whenever fracture happen any of this mid face, there is going to be the downward and displace and the backward displacement of the maxilla, and from back it is attached, right? So from back, these, there is attachment for the soft tissues, there is attachment for the muscles. So when any fracture happens in the mid face, it is going to be like this. So there is going to be an open bite, which is seen in all the three Lefort fractures, and also elongation of the face, which is in the Lefort, all the three fractures. So coming to the Lefort 1 fracture. Now in Lefort 1 fracture, the line runs like this horizontally. So this is the fracture line in the red. So this is from starting from the nasal aperture, piriform aperture, up till the lower one third of the pterygoid plate. So this line is the horizontal line. So Lefort 1 fracture is also known as the horizontal fracture of maxilla, the Guerin's fracture, because the Guerin's sign is seen, floating maxilla, floating fracture, because this, when the fracture occurs, there is a detachment of the whole of the maxilla. So this maxilla, what happens is, when after the injury, so this maxilla, it comes out and it went piche, backward. It comes down and it went backward, because there is an attachment of muscles at the pterygoid plate, the muscles of mastication, lateral pterygoid, medial pterygoid. So there is a muscle attachment. So from the bottom, from the posterior part, it is attached with the muscles, and the anterior part left hanging. So like that, the anterior part left hanging. And this is the reason that there is an anterior open bite, which is seen after the Lefort 1 fracture. So what happens is, this fracture line. So this is the fracture line. Now this is the fracture line. What happens after a Lefort 1 fracture occurs? So like this fracture occurs and there is a detachment of the maxilla like this. Posteriorly it is pulled by the muscles. So posteriorly it is pulled by the muscle and the anterior part left hanging. So there is a maxilla which is floating in the air. So that is why this is also known as the floating fracture, floating maxilla, and because this fracture is a low level fracture. So this is the lowest level fracture if we go for the maxilla. So this is the lowest level fracture. That is why it is also known as the low level fracture, or this is also known as the subzygomatic fracture. Now Lefort 1 and Lefort 2 both are the subzygomatic fracture because the fracture line is below the zygomatic bone, below the zygomatic. So this is the subzygomatic fracture. Also this is also known as the pterygomaxillary dysfunction because there is the maxilla is basically detached. So that is why this is also known as the pterygomaxillary disjunction. Now what happens is, because when first of all when there is a mandible, suppose imagine there is a mandible, so if there is an injury from the mandible like this, there is an injury, so there is a fracture of mandible as well as there is a Lefort 1 fracture. Also what happens when there is a strong blow from a sharp object, strong blow from a sharp object towards the apex of the roots and towards the tooth bearing area, this force doesn't limit itself to the tooth fracture alone, but also it fractures the maxilla, it fractures the Lefort 1 fracture, and the entire segment of the tooth bearing area is detached. So a fracture line is developed here when the entire maxilla is detached and the maxilla keep on floating, and posteriorly because it is pulled by the muscle, so anteriorly it is like pulled like this. So this is the floating maxilla wherein the maxilla is actually detached. So at the maxilla is get aparted from the cranial base, but posteriorly it is still held it by the muscles, by the soft tissue. So the displacement of the maxilla in this case is downward as well as posterior displacement, because the first of all this part is hanging, so this part is detached, so this is a downward, as well as because there is a muscle attachment posteriorly, so posteriorly it is pulled. So the movement is the downward and the backward movement of the fractured segment after the fracture happens at the apices, at the root apices, at this line, so at the low level fracture line. So this is what happens. Now talking about the fracture line, so the fracture pattern for a Guerin fracture or a Lefort 1 fracture is that the fracture starts from the lateral margin of the lateral nasal aperture. So if we are talking about fracture of this part, now it starts from the piriform aperture, the lateral margin. This is the nasal wall, and the lateral margin of the lateral nasal aperture, this fracture starts. And it runs, it because this is a horizontal fracture, as we have talked about earlier. So this is a horizontal fracture. So this line, it runs horizontally like this. It will be like this. And we will cover one by one. So when it starts from the lateral margin of the lateral nasal aperture, and the lines run in a horizontal direction. Now it goes above the nasal floor. So after that, it runs through the anterior wall of the maxillary antrum. So this is the, let me show you. So this part is basically the maxillary antrum. If you can see this inside the maxilla, so I don't want to fracture any bone this time. So this part is the maxillary antrum, if you can see. So the maxillary antrum, this is the anterior part of the maxillary antrum, this is the anterior wall of the maxillary antrum. So this fracture, it passes above the canine fossa. Now you can see the canine fossa, very prominent canine fossa. So this fracture starting from the lateral nasal aperture and the canine fossa, above the canine fossa, also it crosses the anterior wall of the maxillary antrum. Then this fracture goes below the zygomaticobuttress. Now can you see this zygomaticobuttress? This zygomaticobuttress. Now when this fracture line is running, so this fracture line is coming, and it goes below the zygomaticobuttress and it goes posteriorly towards the pterygomaxillary fissure, and it breaks the lower one third of the pterygoid plate. So like that, below the this, and then it fractures the lower one third of the pterygoid plate. So this is about the Lefort 1 fracture. And if we want to draw this fracture is going to be from the lateral nasal aperture above the canine fossa, anterior wall of the maxillary. This is going to be the maxillary antrum, right? So anterior wall of the maxillary antrum, then go below the buttress, and like that posteriorly it fractures the lower one third of the pterygoid plate. So this is about the Lefort 1 fracture. And if we talk about the sign and symptoms now, it is similar to the all the fracture line. Now what happens, because there is a sharp object, a blow from the sharp object. So there is a blow from the sharp object and near the apices of the tooth, near the teeth region. So there is going to be a swelling of the upper lip, because there is going to be a fracture, right? So because of that, there is going to be swelling of that specific region. If it is unilateral, then it is going to be a unilateral swelling. If this is bilateral fracture, then it is going to be a bilateral swelling. And because the maxilla floats, it gets detached, because this is the line, right? So this line, the maxilla, it gets separated and it floats. So when it floats, and posteriorly the posterior teeth touches first. So when the posterior teeth touches first, so there is going to be like this. So there is going to be an anterior open bite. So this is the most significant symptom. This is the most significant sign which we see intraorally, because there is going to be an anterior open bite. See, this happens for all the three fracture, Lefort 1, Lefort 2, Lefort 3. In all the three fractures, we are going to see this anterior open bite. And since there is an anterior open bite, so there will be an elongation in the face, because this maxilla has come now this side. So the overall increase, there is a lower facial height of the patient is increased. So there is going to be increase in the lower facial height. And because there is a fracture at this region, right? So there is going to be a bleeding from the nose. So there is the epistaxis. So bleeding, if this is bilateral, so the bilateral bleeding of the nose is seen. And the patient, because the teeth are not touching, because there is an open bite, because there is the premature occlusion of the posterior teeth, so because of that the patient will not be able to speak, the patient will not be able to chew, because chew the patient cannot because after this this fracture, patient is not able to chew because there is a floating maxilla. How will patient chew? So there is going to be a pain during the speech as well as the mastication. And if we see the intraorally, so there is going to be ecchymosis. Now what is ecchymosis? Ecchymosis is basically discoloration of the skin whenever there is an injury. So what happens, because of the blood vessels, they burst, and there is a blood which is leaking underneath the skin. So below the skin, because of the rupture of the blood vessel, there is going to be discoloration, there is going to be darkened area. So discoloration because of the bleeding which is happening underneath the skin. So because of that, there is ecchymosis, because this fracture is there in the buccal region. So there is going to be ecchymosis once we retract the cheek, and we see that there is ecchymosis in the buccal region. Also, there is going to be a laceration. See, because from a sharp object, injury is there, right? So because of that, there is going to be a laceration in the labial mucosa. So there will be an injury in the soft tissue in the where there is a region of the blow. Where the injury has occurred, there is going to be a laceration in the soft tissue in the labial mucosa. Also, a fractured the maxilla, what happens is this maxilla is floating because this whole of the component is detached, while posteriorly it is still attached because of the soft tissue attachment, because of the muscles attachment. So what happens is, because of this, the maxilla is shifted downward, and because still there is a posterior pull because of the posterior muscle, so because of that there is going to be a downward as well as the backward movement of the maxilla from normal. And because of this, there is going to be an open bite, which I have told you already, which is one of the important part. Now because of this, there is going to be a tenderness in the area. So because of the fracture, always fracture is associated with a pain, so there will be a pain in that particular area. Patient will complain of the pain in that particular area where there is a blow from the sharp object. And when there is a unilateral fracture happens, now when there is only involvement of the one part of the maxilla, the tooth bearing portion, it splits from the median suture. So this basically, the suture splits, and what happens is there is ecchymosis happening at the greater palatine region. So there is also ecchymosis seen near to the molars area, near to the greater palatine vessels. And because of this ecchymosis, this sign is known as the Guerin signs. So there is going to be discoloration at the greater palatine region near to the greater palatine vessels, and this is the Guerin's sign where there is discoloration. This is the reason this fracture is also known as the Guerin's fracture. So this is all about the Lefort 1 fracture. So how do you see, check the Lefort 1 fracture? With the help of a left hand little finger, you are placing on the anterior nasal spine. So like that, and the right hand you are placing your finger, because this is a floating maxilla. In case if it is a Lefort 1 fracture, then there is going to be a mobility like this. So the maxilla is going to be move, is maxilla will move like this if this is a Lefort 1 fracture. So this is how we check the Lefort 1 fracture. Also on percussion, there will be a cracked, dull cracked sound which will be heard on percussion. So on percussion, if it is a fractured maxilla, then the sound of the upper teeth will come like this on percussion. See, a cracking will be heard like this. A cracking in the voice. How the potter checks his pots, if there is any cracking in the pot. So the same way the fracture is going to sound like this, because there is going to be a fine line. So the same sound is going to come. And if it is normal, it will sound like this. Like this. So this is the dull cracked sound which on percussion, on the case of fracture, which is heard. So this is about Lefort 1 fracture. Next video we are going to talk about Lefort 2 fracture, and after that Lefort 3, and after that we will cover the treatment of the midfacial fractures. So if you enjoy the video, then like it, share it, subscribe it, and share it with your friends if you enjoy watching our channel. And if you have learned something new today, and or I have made it easier for you to understand, then hit the comment box and the like button, because this helped me to help you skyrocket your career knowledge while you are straight here with your family.